I'm Michael Schiavello, and welcome to One on One with The Voice. Garry Tonon, thank you for joining me today.
Yeah, man, thanks.
If a cult is defined as a system of veneration and devotion towards a particular figure or object, could Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, particularly in the USA, be called a cult?
Oh, yeah, I'd say so for sure. I would say that there's direct correlations between the behavior that you would see in someone that is in a part of a cult and a part of somebody who's a part of a jiu-jitsu academy that's very enthusiastic about it, I would say. I'd say that maybe not everybody involved is quite on the same level, like that would be, that you would say is cult-like behavior, but the people that are very enthusiastic about it, the people that devote their lives to jiu-jitsu, I would say very much so.
You've stated that the mats are the only place you feel human. Do you really feel no sense of your own humanity anywhere else other than the mats?
I wouldn't say that I don't feel any sense of my humanity anywhere else, but it's just one of the places that makes you feel more alive, more so than any other area. I think we kind of get, as civilized as we get as human beings, especially, you know, me living in, you know, going to New York every day, being a part of a big city, you know, out here in Tokyo, you get taken apart and taken away from kind of the more animalistic tendencies that any other animal would have, or, you know, that are just normally involved in their lives. And as you start to get involved in any type of combat martial art, I think it starts to bring some of that back. The same sort of thing that you would see when you watch two primates trying to battle out for territory, or, you know, over food or over whatever the case may be. It kind of gives you that same sense of being as more of an animal as opposed to just, a person walking around, no offense, in a suit. Yeah. And, you know, we're doing an interview right now. We're all very civilized and, you know, I'll have a cup of tea and this, that, and the other thing. But, you know, all of this essentially is just kind of a little bit of a, I don't want to call it fake, but it's, you know, it's more of a facade than anything, because when it comes down to who we really are as human beings, you know, we're not a suit, we're not a tie, we're, you know, we'd be naked in the wild trying to survive, you know. And I think jiu-jitsu and martial arts brings me way more back to those instincts than anything else does.
You have ADHD.
Correct.
Which a lot of people see as a negative, but has ADHD mm-hmm. actually given you any advantages on your way to becoming a world champion grappler?
I think so. I think I looked at ADHD as a child growing up very much as a negative thing because it was constantly a source of criticism from teachers, parents, this, that, and the other thing, of the types of behaviors that I was exhibiting as a child and how it would affect my learning and things like that. So it was always kind of seen as a negative thing. But as I got older and older and I was able to gain more world experience, I started to realize that the way that I react to certain situations actually can be a positive thing, dependent upon the way that my attention is directed and dependent upon the way my impulses are directed. For instance, in jiu-jitsu or mixed martial arts, you have a very short period of time to think before you have to act, which is something that's a characteristic of someone who has ADHD. They're very impulsive. They tend to just make decisions without thinking for too long. They're much more quick thinking, if you will, to act on whatever it is. So I believe that that's made me much more dynamic, much more creative in my grappling, because I won't second guess myself, grappling or mixed martial arts. There's less of an opportunity for me to second guess myself. Sometimes that can be a bad thing, but I think as long as you're developing good positive habits in the training environment that aren't going to be putting you in danger, when I make those split second decisions and those I act on my impulses, I believe it'll only work to my benefit when I actually get on the stage and compete.
If you were trapped on a desert island for 5 years and can only listen to one of these three people talk the entire time, who would you choose? Tom DeBlas, John Danaher, or Henzo Gracie?
So I could only choose one?
Only one.
Only one, and I'm trapped for how long?
5 years.
5 years. Whew. All right, let me think. It's tough because those are literally like three people that I think like I could spend any amount of time listening to those guys talk, because they're just, all of them are so charismatic in their own way. they all have really positive things to offer about their character that they give to the people that they speak to. But they also have a very storytelling-esque type of speech where what they're saying is always exciting, regardless of what the lesson is behind it. With Henzo, with Tom, with John, they're always trying, even if it's not an intentional thing. Whenever you hear them talk, it's almost always something motivational. It's always something inspirational to your being. So, it's still exciting. Like, it's not just somebody like, well, you should do this, and this, and you know, they still find a way to tell it like you're watching a movie or something like that. If I had to pick absolutely one, I guess I go with John. But John will probably end up killing me on the island, I feel like, more so than the other ones. I think I'd be most likely to survive with, I feel like Henzo would be least likely to try to kill me. I think Tom or John both would definitely murder me within the first like 6 months. I don't think they'd be able to handle being around me personally.
Which of these career losses would you most like to get a do-over on?
Oh boy.
The rear naked choke to Ron Gracie at ADCC, the flying triangle to Antonio Carlos, or the wrist lock to Matias Diniz?
So I never want a do-over for anything really. I like to try to not have any regrets really. I think all of those were learning experiences. But in terms of being able to have another match against any of those individuals, I think that the most exciting matchup for me would be to have another match with Crone and have an opportunity to be able to beat him, because I think now if we did it, it could be mixed martial arts or it could be jiu-jitsu, and either one of those I think would be very exciting, something that a lot of people would like to see. And it was just so long ago that happened. Either the other two matches, in terms of like a do-over situation, something that was kind of, that I had always felt was just kind of like, oh, I don't really know what the hell happened there, was the Mateus situation with the wrist lock. He just kind of like fell onto my wrist, like from half guard, just like put all of his weight into it. And I just yelled like a dog would yell if you stepped on its tail. Like, I didn't even realize there was a submission happening or anything like that. So when I yelled, he got up and like thought that he submitted me. And not to say that he didn't, because based on the rules, he did, you know. So I didn't argue it or anything like that, whatever. It's a submission loss. You can see me not being able to come to terms with that very well. So yeah, that'd be one that like, if I did have any regrets, that's definitely in the category, and I'd love to have another match with him.
After your last win in one championship, you dropped an elbow in celebration that some people say was the people's elbow. Uh-huh. I thought it looked more like a Randy Macho Man Savage elbow. Was it either of those, or was it something completely different?
I wish I could say that it was. Going back to the whole ADHD thing, I think it was just like an impulsive thing that I did. I had finished my opponent with elbows, and that's when they called the TKO and they stopped the fight. And I was just like, I feel like jumping up in the air and throwing an elbow at the ground now. I don't know. That's what was going on in my head. So I wish I could say it was just emulation of my favorite wrestlers, but nah, it was just me.
What's one misconception people have about you?
Misconception. I pretty much lay it all out on the line. I think I let everybody know how it is, but what do people look at and I disagree with the way that they feel? I don't know, can you think of anything?
I'll be totally honest with you.
Yeah.
So when I first met you a few months ago, when you made your debut for one championship, and I'd heard all about your success in grappling, I thought you were going to be arrogant as hell. And you're actually the complete opposite. You're humble, you're fun to be around, you're always joking, you're super smart. Uh-huh. You're the most unarrogant person I've met, but I honestly thought you'd be arrogant.
All right, well, there you go. So let's do that. I think it's easier for somebody else to answer that question, because obviously, when you think about other people's perception of yourself, it's never exactly accurate. You know, you always kind of, you perceive yourself one way and everybody else perceives you a different way. I saw something interesting, it was some quote, but I'm not 100% sure who said it, that like, it's almost as if there are thousands of you here on Earth. It's not just what you see, but it's what each individual sees.
I read the same quote.
Yeah.
Everyone sees a different version of you.
Yeah.
So the version your mum sees of you is going to be different from my version, different from his or her version. Mm-hmm. Everyone's going to see a different version. Hence, there are going to be thousands of versions of Garry Tonon.
Yeah, which is really interesting to think about, because everybody has a little bit of a different... You've experienced different parts of my personality. My mother has obviously experienced different parts. So you're always going to like kind of think about a person a little bit differently. It's interesting.
What's one thing you believe to be true that nobody else believes?
One thing I believe to be true, that the earth is flat. No, I'm kidding. No, man. I wouldn't say no one else believes this, but I believe that we're going to see a resurgence of submission grappling again in mixed martial arts to a really high effective degree. I also think that you guys are going to, you know, you're going to see leg locks, you know, being used more and more effectively in mixed martial arts. We did it in jiu-jitsu with my team, and we're going to do it in mixed martial arts as well. Whether or not people believe that that's going to be the way to go, or that, you know, I think a lot of people believe that grappling is fading out or it's not as effective or whatever the case may be, well, I'm here to prove that it's not.
Well, I think this interview is going to serve as pretty good proof.
Yeah.
Gary, thank you so much, mate. I appreciate it.
Appreciate it.